Every woodworker has their own process. When building cabinets, some build the face frames first, and then they build the boxes to fit. When cutting dovetail joints, some cut the pins first, and then they cut the tails to fit. Others do those things the other way around. But when it comes to a mortise and tenon joint, the process is pretty universal. You cut the mortise first, then the tenon. I'm sure there's some exceptions out there, but I don't personally know anyone who cuts the tenon first and then the mortise. Why? Because while there are some basic rules for sizing mortises and tenons, such as how thick a tenon should be for the strongest joint, this is just a general guide. The most important factor is the tool you use to create the mortise. It's been true since the beginning of woodworking. If Pappy Nubs had a half-inch mortising chisel, guess how wide all of his mortises were. And today, if you have a half-inch Forstner bit or a 3/8-inch router bit, your mortises will be that wide. A tenon, on the other hand, is not dependent on the size of the tool you're using. A handsaw or a bandsaw or a table saw or even a router can cut a tenon to any size. That's why we cut the mortise first, then we cut the tenon to fit inside. Because it's far easier to shave a little bit off a tenon than it is to widen the mortise. We've made videos about cutting mortises before. I'll link to one below if you want to check it out. But that's the easy part. Today, let's talk about the most crucial part of the joint, cutting and fitting the tenon. There are a lot of ways to do it. Today, we'll use a table saw and a dado stack. Honestly, this is a great way to cut tenons because once you get it set up, it's fast, easy, and consistent. If you don't have a dado stack, you can do exactly the same thing, just as I show it in this video, with a router table, with a fence, and a straight bit. So watch this whole process. You're going to pick up some important tips along the way. We begin by installing a sacrificial fence made from a strip of plywood. We're using special fence clamps, which I really like because they stay out of the way. I'll link to them below this video, or you can use regular clamps. The sacrificial fence makes it possible to partially cover the blade. You'll see why that's important shortly. The tenons of this particular project are about 3/4 inch long, so the fence is set to expose almost 3/4 inch of the dado set. Not the full amount just yet, only about 5/8 or so. If your tenon must be wider than your dado set, I'll show you what to do about that at the end of the video. A sacrificial fence is also added to the miter gauge. This will support the fibers along the shoulder of the tenon and prevent chip out on the backside as the blade exits the cut. Note how the miter fence nearly touches the rip fence. That extra space will give you some room for adjustment in a moment. Be sure your miter gauge is square to the fence, which should, of course, be parallel to the blade. If your miter fence is set at a slight angle, your tenon shoulders won't be square and you'll end up with gaps. Now turn the saw on and begin slowly raising the blade, embedding it into the bottom edge of the fence. Don't go too high. You'll want to sneak up on the full height through test cuts. The first test cut is to fine-tune the rip fence position. The end of the workpiece is placed against the fence and the miter gauge guides it safely through the cut on one side. Then the length of the tenon is measured and the fence is adjusted as needed to achieve the precise length you're looking for. Once that's dialed in, make a cut on the other side of the workpiece and measure the tenon's thickness. You can do this either with a caliper or better yet, by slipping it right into the mortise itself. A well-fitting tenon should not require a mallet to fit inside a mortise. If it's too tight, it will never go in once you add glue and swell the fibers. Remember, any adjustment you make to the blade height will be doubled as you cut two sides of the tenon, so make tiny adjustments to dial in the fit. Once it's dialed in, that little bit of fussing will pay off big as you can cut all the matching tenons in the project with the same setup. If your tenons require side cheeks as well as face cheeks, repeat the setup process on the edge of the workpiece to trim the tenon to width. While it's nice to have a perfectly fitting tenon all the way around, there is some room for error in the tenon's width. Most of the joint's strength comes from the larger glue surfaces on well-fitting face cheeks. The side cheeks of the tenon provide a much smaller glue surface, and while the tenon's width does help counter racking forces, a looser fit along the width won't spoil the joint. I say this not because I'm encouraging you to be sloppy when you sneak up on the blade height to trim the tenon to width, but because it may be difficult to test the fit of a square tenon inside a mortise with rounded ends from the tool you used to cut it. A caliper will help you compare the inside measurement of the mortise to the outer measurement of the tenon, but when you eventually round off the corners of the tenon to match the round mortise, you might accidentally take too much off the width anyway. That's not a big deal. As long as the wide tenon cheeks fit well, the joint will still be plenty strong. Speaking of rounding off the corners, a sharp chisel does a decent job of it, but keep the workpiece secured in a vise and both hands behind the cutting edge of your chisel. You can easily slip and sustain a devastating injury if you place your hand in harm's way. I prefer to use a file or a rasp to round my corners. I find it's faster and easier to round off the tenon than it is to square the corners of the mortise itself. Now there are two more important points we need to cover. First is a matter of safety and the other is a common cause of frustration. In regards to safety, surely you've been told you should never cross-cut a workpiece with a miter gauge while the end of that workpiece is touching the rip fence. It's just asking for kickback. And that is definitely true if you're cutting the end off a workpiece. That little bit that's left over can catch between the fence and the blade and fly back at you. But in this case, we're not creating a loose offcut. The dado set is turning it all into sawdust, so there's nothing to kick back. That's why it's safe in this case to put the end of the workpiece against the rip fence. One source of frustration for many new furniture makers are gaps along the tenon shoulders where they don't fully seat. There are three common causes for this. One cause might be that the miter gauge was not square to the blade, so you end up cutting your shoulders at an angle. Another cause may be the fence moved sometime during the process. That fence is your positive stop. It ensures that every shoulder is the same. Once you dial in the fence position, it should stay put until every tenon in the project is fully finished. If you move it, even a little bit, your shoulders won't be even all the way around the joint and you'll have gaps. Make sure you have all your stock and a couple extra pieces ready to go at the start so you won't have to move the fence and rip new work pieces in the middle of the process. A third cause for error is paying too much attention to the length of the tenon and not enough to the length of the workpiece. For example, this table has four stretchers. All must be exactly the same length. I may be really careful to cut a precise 3/4-inch long tenon on each end of each stretcher, but the tenon will be hidden in a hole. If it's a little too short, it's not a big deal. More important than the length of the tenon is the distance between the tenon's shoulders on each end of the workpiece. If that distance is too short, it's definitely going to show. So be sure to cut all your stretcher stock to exactly, and I mean exactly, the same overall length. Then your fence position will ensure that the tenons themselves are consistent, and your stretchers will all match and seat evenly. One last thing. Suppose you need a tenon that's longer than the full thickness of your dado stack. It's not a problem. While it's nice if the dado can be buried in the fence, it's okay if the fence must be moved past the dado to set the tenon's full length. You merely have to cut the tenon in one or two more passes until the end of the workpiece finally seats against the fence on the final pass. Your tenons will still come out consistent because the fence still serves as your positive stop. Tenons are a fundamental part of woodworking. Everyone should know how to properly cut and fit them. I hope this video helps you in your next project. If you get what you pay for, then why are bandsaw blades so inexpensive at sawblade.com? Seriously, they're as good as any I've used, they come in any size you need, and they cost quite a bit less than anything comparable at the woodworking retailers. Try them for yourself at the link below this video. You'll see. Wait, don't go yet. If you're new here, please subscribe and remember to ring the bell. I would really appreciate that. Give us a thumbs up, or better yet, leave us a comment. I always read them. And be sure to check out the latest issue of Stumpy Nubs Woodworking Journal. It's always packed with tips, tricks, and tutorials designed to make you a better woodworker.